الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah. We praise Him abundantly the way He deserves it, and we send the peace and the blessings, and we ask Allah to exalt the mention of Prophet Muhammad, his companions, and all those who follow them on the righteous path until the day of judgment. Before it's too late. I'm assuming that everyone here could guess by the title of this particular lecture what we will be discussing. And naturally, a Muslim and any human being who becomes who gets guided to Islam understands that any act of worship that we perform is mercy from Allah, facilitation from Allah. So now we are in the month of Ramadan. Perhaps those who don't have any excuses are fasting. Perhaps you were praying last night. Perhaps you were remembering Allah on the way here. Perhaps you enjoined the good and you forbade the evil. Perhaps you kept your kinship ties. Whatever act of worship either one of us has performed, it was facilitation and success given to us by Allah. If Allah Azza wa Jal decreed that we won't do these acts of worship, you can't do it on your own. We are helpless unless Allah Azza wa Jal facilitates these things for us. So part of this concept is to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Him the way He deserves it for the acts of worship that He has facilitated for us. And the ones who benefit are us. It's not like Allah Azza wa Jal becomes more majestic or more rich or more powerful through the acts of worship performed by His servants. Rather, Allah Azza wa Jal is the self-sufficient. He's in no need of our worship, but He facilitates the worship for us, and we are the ones who gain. We are the ones who are gaining. It's as if you have a boss and he hires you. He allows you to work at his company. Let's say it's a factory where you make some products. He lets you keep the product and he pays you money for the hours you spend there. He doesn't get anything. You work, you produce a gadget, supposedly you're supposed to give it to him as your job and take the money in return. He gives you both. How would you feel about him? Mia mia. That's the ultimate boss. But you know, they're not available nowadays. It's the other way around. They take but they don't give you anything in return. Allah musta'an. Illa man rahim Allah. But subhanallah, walillahi al-mathalu al-a'la, and to Allah belongs the highest example. This is our affair with Allah, that He facilitates the acts of worship for us. We perform them, we benefit. And Allah Azza wa Jal remains self-sufficient. So, how do we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There are a number of ways. The one that is most crucial in our lives is through actions. Praising Allah and thanking Him by utilizing the blessings and the sustenance that we have received from Him Azza wa Jal, and utilizing this in ways that are pleasing to Him, where we don't get ni'mah and then we disobey Him with it. And this is a big door, because the sight is a ni'mah, and the hearing is a ni'mah, and the understanding is a ni'mah, and the knowledge is a ni'mah, and the food is a ni'mah, the drink and the whole thing, everything we have. وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Every single bounty that we have is from Allah. So it becomes a little serious that we use everything that we have been given by Allah in ways that are pleasing to Him. Alhamdulillah, Allah facilitates this to His servants. We will fall into shortcomings because of our nature as the children of Adam. We are sinful. But then we have the door of tawbah, repentance, where we repent and turn in repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seek His forgiveness, and then Allah promised that He will forgive these sins. And if you repent, Allah will accept your repentance. And good deeds erase bad deeds. إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. So we have always ways to clear ourselves from the problems we face. We are right now during in a very blessed time, the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, narrated the hadith on the authority of Aisha, narrated by Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him, that Aisha said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر شد مئزرة وأحيا ليلة وأيقظ أهله. She described, of course, Aisha, the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, who lived with him, who observed his behavior at home. And this is something that is very important for the Muslims. And this is from the mercy of Allah that his wife, Aisha radiallahu anha, was young at the time of marriage. She was knowledgeable, she had the good memory, and she had the understanding of the deen. This is all beneficial for the ummah, for those who try to accuse the Prophet ﷺ of whatever they accuse him because of his marriage to Aisha. Most of the things that related to his personal, private life, which we also have a way to follow, an example in him to follow, is usually narrated by Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. In this particular hadith, she said that whenever the last 10 nights would start, the beginning of the last 10 nights of Ramadan, the Prophet ﷺ would tighten his belt, and he would stay up the whole night in prayer, and some of the scholars said almost the whole night, and he would wake up his family. He would wake up his wives and his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha and her husband Ali radiallahu anhu. He used to wake him up, أَفَلَا تُصَلِّيَانَ, should you get up and get some prayer done? So he alayhi salam was not only concerned about himself, rather he was concerned about those who were around him because of the responsibility that each one of us has for the people around him or her. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. Each one of you is the shepherd, and you'll be asked about those who are under his responsibility. And Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. O you who believe, protect yourselves and your family from the fire. So this is an obligation on each one of us, whether a male or a female, that you make sure that you are upon the right path and those around you are also upon the right path. So the Prophet ﷺ would wake up his wives and enjoin upon them prayer in order to benefit from this blessed time. Why? Because of one night. One night, Laylatul Qadr. The reason why the Prophet ﷺ used to exert himself in the last 10 nights, other than the first 20, is because of Laylatul Qadr. Because Aisha also said that in the first 20 days the Prophet ﷺ would mix. He would get some, he would sleep some, pray some. He will eat, he will stop eating. But during the last 10 nights, his behavior was different. He was overwhelmed and over-concerned with establishing the Salah and receiving the blessings of Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr is a very virtuous night. It has been mentioned in the Quran in at least two occasions. One that everybody knows, which is Surah Al-Qadr, يعني, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. We have the other one in Surah Al-Dukhan, where Allah Azza wa Jal says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, حاميم والكتاب المبين, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مُبَارَكَةٍ إِنَّا كُنَّا مُنذِرِينَ فيها يفرق كل أمر حكيم أمرا من عندنا إِنَّا كُنَّا مُرْسِلِينَ. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran interpretation of the meaning in English, حاميم, which is two letters that no one knows what they mean but Allah. This is from the miracles of the Quran, and the knowledge is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so we don't go into the explanation because none of the righteous predecessors did so. وَالْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينَ, by the manifest book which makes everything clear. This is Allah swearing by the Quran. Manifest, it makes everything clear. In terms of things that are ambiguous, you will find the answer in the Quran. Verily we have sent it down on a blessed night. On a blessed night, verily we were ever warning our creation, Allah Azza wa Jalla, ever warning the creation from the torment of the fire by sending the messengers and telling them that they must establish Tawheed, oneness of Allah, worshipping Him alone, not taking any gods besides Him, not having other gods, not Jesus, not Mary, not anybody else on the planet. Everyone is the servant of Allah, and Allah is the only one deserving of worship. This was the objective of the prophets and the messengers. Then Allah says, therein, every decreed matter is ordained. No, therein there is a decree of every ordainment. On that night, everything is ordained. Who will live? Who will die? Your sustenance. Whether there's going to be poverty, whether there's going to be wealth among the people. Everything is decreed on that night. Some of the scholars said the angels received the information on that night. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said in the interpretation of this meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended, sent down the Quran on Laylatul Qadr from the Lawh al-Mahfuz to Bayt al-Izzah, which is in the first heaven. And then from that moment on, it was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in stages over 23 years. So the whole Quran was revealed as one from Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, the sacred tablet, which is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the first heaven. Then from there, Jibreel alayhi salam continued to send the revelation accordingly for the need of the Muslims over the period of 23 years. This is among the interpretations of this particular ayah by Ibn Kathir and the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Laylatul Qadr is then a very virtuous night, and it has many characteristics. Among them is the one that we mentioned earlier, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees the affairs of a servant on that particular day. The second characteristic or virtue is the fact that it is blessed. إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مُبَارَكَةٍ. And whenever something is blessed by Allah, then this is the best thing in the world. You do not want to have anything that is not blessed. In other words, having a date, one date, that has barakah in it, is better than having a whole refrigerator of food with no barakah in it. Because the one with the barakah has barakah from Allah. It will be good. It will not be used against you on the Day of Judgment. It will be pleasing to Allah. It will get you closer to Allah. Your body may even react to it in a better way than something that has the blessings removed. So this is a very crucial idea. The fact that we want to seek the blessings in our sustenance, and this is an indication that we should earn them in a halal fashion. Because if your money is halal, then there's barakah in it, even if the salary is small. But when you want to expand on the expense of haram, and you start dealing with interest and riba and other things that are not permissible, thinking your money is going to grow, it's not going to grow. The number may grow, but the barakah will be removed, and this money will never be of benefit. And if for whatever reason it benefit that individual in the dunya, it will not be a benefit in the hereafter. And that, so that you lost. We will be losers in this fashion. Where our objective is the hereafter, not the dunya. So the fact that that night is blessed is an indication that we should take advantage of it. And we will deal with that inshallah somewhat in some sort of details in a little bit. The third characteristic of this particular night is that it is peace. Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-fajr. It is peace. There's peace until the arrival of the dawn, until the morning time. And if something is peaceful, as Mujahid, the Tabi'i, may Allah have mercy on him, explained, this he said the shayateen are not allowed to cause any evil during that particular night. This is why what is intended by salam, that it is peaceful. Another virtue is that the angels come down with mercy. تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. The angels and the ruh, which is Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, Gabriel, descend by the command of their Lord with every decree. And their presence is a source of mercy, because the angels usually come down seeking the halaqat al-dhikr, the places, the circles of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they come with mercy from Allah. So the fact that the angels are descending is an indication that there will be mercy. So you have mercy, you have blessings, you have the fact that everything is decreed on that particular night. And then to add, to top this off, it is خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. It is better than 1,000 months, which is more or less, whether the day is 29 or 30 days, you're talking about 83 years and some, and 4 months, or maybe less than that, depending on the moon sighting. But more or less, 83 years. One night is equal to 83 years. Now you really don't understand what that means until you sit down for a little bit and think it over in your mind. You know what I'm saying? Now you go to the mall. You see discounts, promotions, sales. You will never find anything like that. You will never find a promotion where you do something and then you will get money for 83 years, or you will get clothes for 83 years. No such promotion has ever existed. Rather, everything is, yani, they give you something little in return for a lot that you spend. So this is a promotion by Allah. You worship Allah on one night, and as the scholars explained it, you will be given the reward of worshiping Allah for 83 years on one night. This is the biggest deal. Maybe most of us will not even live up to 83 years. So this is longer than someone's lifespan. This is longer than the average person's lifespan. Most people don't live up to that particular age. So one night of worship will give you the reward of 83 years of worship. So the question remains, where are we supposed to be and what are we supposed to do on these nights? We know that, and I'm not going to go with the narrations because everybody pretty much knows, that it falls inshallah on the odd nights. Yani the 21st, 23rd, 25th, 27th and 29th. One of them. The scholars differed in terms of the 27th night, whether it is definitely that night. But the most correct opinion, in order to bring harmony between all the authentic narrations, is that it is in one of the odd nights. Some say generally the last 10 nights, more particularly the odd nights, which I just mentioned earlier. So this is more or less 5 days. Yani, if you were to exert yourself on these 5 nights properly, you will definitely land on Laylatul Qadr inshallah. 100%. And you will get the reward of 83 years. So really, we must be careful from the tricks of the shaitan. Somehow, he will get you busy. Huh? Eid is coming. You need new soap. And you need a new this. And for this, you need a new jilbab. You need a new clothes. You need a new shoes. I must go to the market. Oh, we're going to make ma'mool for Eid. So some people go spend the whole night between the shopping and the mall and the clothes and the preparation for this and for that and soap operas and television, while the people are worshipping Allah and saving themselves from the fire. Some individuals will be careless, as if they got so many good deeds, they are in no need of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on these particular nights. And we ask Allah the afiyah, the protection and the safety from this particular lifestyle. And so I'm reminding myself anew. Tonight, for example, will be the night of the 23rd, inshallah. Don't get busy. Don't get busy with some worldly affair that will be of no benefit. It will be of no benefit. If there are any preparations that need to be made, we should make them during the day. The night is dedicated for worship. Of course, there are urgent matters sometimes. I'm not saying that, you know, you will leave alone obligations and taking care of your family who may need to eat and just go stay and pray. You must do the obligations, but we're saying if it's something that is not necessary, then we must engage ourselves with some acts of worship on these particular nights. Whether it is praying, whether it is supplicating, whether it is remembering Allah or reciting the Quran. All these are acts of worship that we can engage in. Aisha radiallahu anha asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what shall I do if I know that it's Laylatul Qadr? What shall I say? What is the dua? He taught her, alayhi salatu salam, say, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni. Oh Allah, you're the one who forgives and pardons. And you love to forgive and pardon, so forgive and pardon me. This is the dua that we must repeatedly say during these nights. In your sujood, before the tasdeem, while you're sitting, while you're lying down, while you're standing. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni. Very short sentence. If some people here don't read Arabic, they don't know it, ask someone. The average Muslim knows this. Let them repeat it for you 15 times. Write it down in English letters, you know, the transliteration. Allahumma A-L-L-A-U, etc. So you will know what to say. So this is among the things that we must be mindful of, inshallah, that we want to actually take advantage of this time. Repeat this particular dua, hoping that Allah Azza wa Jal will bless us by being among those who will be worshipping Him on that night. The virtue of that is that you will be protected from the fire and you will have your previous sins forgiven. Because in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whomever stays up in prayer, whomever does qiyam, it doesn't even mean necessarily prayer, whomever worships Allah on the night of Qadr, believing in Allah, that Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed this and had made this a real reality, that you will really gain. It's not just, we're not just talking about numbers, wallah, 83 years, this is something that is fictional. This is something real. Believing in that. And ihtisaban, and seeking the reward with Allah. Seeking that you want that particular reward from Allah. غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whatever sins he had committed in the past, he or she, then those will be forgiven. So we'll be back like a newborn baby. So this is among the virtues of that particular night. عَتْق مِنَ النَّارِ, being saved from the fire, having your previous sins forgiven, you are in a blessed night, full of mercy, the decrees are written on that night, the angels descend, Jibreel descends, you're following the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're making dua, you're making dhikr, you're taking advantage of the season. You are taking advantage of the season. This is the season that Allah Azza wa Jalla has given us to get closer to Him. So we don't want to let it pass and be among the losers. Because the Prophet ﷺ once got on the minbar and he said, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. Three times. The companions, may Allah be pleased with them, questioned that particular action of the Prophet ﷺ, said, O Messenger of Allah, you got on the minbar and you said, Ameen, three times. What made you do so? He said, Jibreel just came to me and told me that basically the more or less the meaning in English, to, I don't know how to put it really. If the Ramadan comes in, and one of the Muslims does not have all of his sins forgiven, then may he be distant from Allah and permitted to the fire. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Ameen, meaning may Allah accept. You do not want to have Ramadan equal to other months. At the same time, we don't want to be extreme and make Ramadan the only time we know Allah. This is another extreme. One extreme is Ramadan is like every other month. Some individuals disobey Allah during Ramadan, continue their old ways. The Ramadan does not affect them in any way, shape or form. The other extreme is that some people only worship Allah in Ramadan. As soon as Ramadan is over and Eid begins, khalas. Go back to lying, go back to cheating, go back to abandoning the salah, go back to being neglectful of the obligations, go back to the previous things that we were doing before Ramadan, they go right back to them after Ramadan. As if the Lord of Ramadan is different than the Lord of the rest of the months. And this is not the case. So we don't want to be seasonal Muslims either. Where we only worship Allah in Ramadan, and as soon as Ramadan is over, khalas, yalla, everything is back to normal. Hopefully we'll make it to the next Ramadan. This is not really the behavior of someone who truly believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment and accountability and the hellfire and paradise and all the things that Allah has promised. Someone who truly believes, he will exert himself his whole life in order to be among the successful on the Day of Judgment, not only in the month of Ramadan. And this has been mentioned in many verses in the Quran. Allah says in Surah Al-Isra, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعَاجِلَةَ عَجَّلْنَا لَهُ فِيهَا مَا نَشَاءُ لِمَنْ نُرِيدُ ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْمُومًا مَدْحُورًا وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُمْ مَشْكُورًا. Whomever desires this quick passing life, Allah says, we will readily give him and grant him what we will to whom we want. But then we will prepare for him the hellfire, where he will dwell in it, disgraced and neglected. No one will turn to him or try to save him. This is the first category of human beings. Those who desire this quick passing life. Those who are overwhelmed in this life of this world. They believe that everything must be accomplished now. They are careless about the hereafter. Careless about the Day of Judgment, careless about the actions that they perform in this life. And Allah Azza wa Jal says that He may give these individuals what they are seeking. If you do want this world, Allah will give to whomever He wills, whatever He wants. He may give you a lot of money. a lot of force, a lot of power. But that's on the expense of the hellfire on the day of judgment. And we don't want to be among the first category. We don't want to be among those who favor the life of this dunya over the hereafter. The other category is those, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةَ وَسَعَى لَهَا سَعْيَهَا. And whomever desires the hereafter, the life to come, and he strives with the efforts that are due for it. Strives. Notice the word سَعَى, different than عَمِل. عَمِلَ لَهَا. And سَعَى indicates that there's effort. You exert yourself. فَأُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ سَعْيُهُ مَشْكُورًا. Those are the ones who will have their actions appreciated, thanked, and rewarded with goodness. Allah says in Surah Al-Kahf, وَاضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا وخير أملا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell us and strike for them the similitude of this life of this world. What is the example of this life of this world? It is like rain that we send down from the sky. Then it mingles with the vegetation of the earth so it becomes fresh and green. But soon it will dry and become broken, which the winds scatter. And verily Allah is able to do all things. To understand this method that Allah Azza wa Jalla struck, the life of this world is like rain that comes from the sky. It mingles with the earth, so it becomes beautiful. You see the plants growing and the flowers and the roses and the vegetation. And as soon as your heart becomes attached to it, and you think that you are, you've taken over it and you're in control, life is smooth, everything is good, all of a sudden it becomes dry, it breaks, and some wind comes and takes it away, which is death. Right when the son of Adam is in the midst of his life enjoying himself, all of a sudden, before he graduates, before he gets the job, before he makes the money, before he finishes paying off the car, death comes and everything is gone. Then we'll be responsible for what we were doing before that particular moment. So this is why a preparation must be made. And Allah is able to do all things. Then Allah taught us about the reality of this life. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. Wealth and children are the adornment of this life of this world. They're the adornment, they decorate it. You love money, we love money. We love children, you know, you brag with your children, oh, these are my children, he's this and he does this and he, you know, he's a hafiz and he speaks three languages. You know, everybody's, is happy with his children. He thinks the children are the most special on the planet. Everybody thinks that. Anyways, so these are the adornment of this life of this world. But then Allah Azza wa Jalla told us what the real benefit is. That the good deeds that one of us performs from worshipping Allah and loving Him and obeying the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and establishing the salah, paying the zakah, remembering Allah, enjoining the good, forbidding the evil, are more lasting with your Lord in terms of rewards and in respect of hope. So the good deeds that we perform are the ones that will last longer, because these move with you after you die. These move with you after you die, the good deeds remain. أبقى وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. It is better for the muttaqeen. And they are better in respect of hope, meaning hope of you entering Jannah and being saved from the fire. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu an abih qal, أخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمنكبي فقال كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. رواه البخاري. Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, said that the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم grabbed him by his shoulder, trying to get affectionate with him alayhi salatu wasalam, for the speech to be more effective. You see, whenever there's physical interaction between the people of the same gender, that is of course, sometimes it is more effective. You know, when you grab your brother like this, say, Akhi, fear Allah. It's not the same when you do it over the phone. It's not the same when you send it in a text message. So the Prophet ﷺ grabbed him by his shoulder to give him a sincere advice. He said, be in this life as if you are a stranger or a wayfarer or a traveler. That's another definition for that. Be in this life as if you are a stranger or someone who is just traveling. The scholars, when interpreting this particular hadith, deduce many benefits from it. What happens, ya akhwan, brothers and sisters, when you are a traveler, the first one, you are a stranger. A stranger has a quality. He never belongs. A stranger never belongs. Now you here. I don't know how many Saudis are here. For the non-Saudis, you live in this country. Maybe you've been here for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, right? But regardless, you are still a stranger. You don't feel home until you go back home. Right? You don't feel like you're home until you go back home. People look like you, they speak like you, they eat like you, they act like you. That's home. If you're from the Philippines, the home is the Philippines. Even if you've been here for 20 years. If you've been from another country, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. Why? You say, I'm going back home. Where are you going? I'm going back home for vacation. You don't consider here home, although you live here. You're a resident. Why? Because you are a stranger. There's an issue of language. There's an issue of culture. There are a number of issues. Even if you adapt to them, you cannot do 100%. You cannot be like the local people. So notice now the Prophet ﷺ said, be in this dunya like a stranger. A stranger never really feels he belongs until he goes back home. And the condition of the believer is as such. You never really feel like you belong in this dunya until you make it home in the hereafter. Until you put 2 feet in Jannah, then you are home. Once we enter Jannah, if Allah, may Allah allow us to Jannah, and you have your 2 feet in, khalas, there's no more going out, then you are home. Now, we are strangers. So a stranger doesn't become attached to this dunya because it is not his home. The other example that Prophet ﷺ gave him, he said, be in this dunya like a traveler. A traveler has one goal, to make it to his destination as quick as possible, as easy as possible, without any problems, hassles or burden. And you usually travel light. When you go back to your country, do you pack your air condition and your TV, if you have a TV, your refrigerator, your couches? No. You travel light. You take the things that you need, your clothes, your passport, whatever. Because a person who travels does not want to take with him things that will prevent him from continuing. I mean, you try to go to the airport with a refrigerator behind you, they're going to send you right back home. Say, man, you can't get this. I put it under the seat. So it doesn't fit under, it doesn't even fit in the thing of the airplane, you know, in the luggage base. You're going to put it under the seat. They will send you back home. So an intelligent individual only takes with him whatever will help him make it on his trip. You don't carry much. You don't worry much. You don't get attached to too many things because you want to make it to the destination. Likewise, the condition of the believer. He wants to travel to the dunya, to the hereafter, so he does not become attached. He does not overburden himself with responsibilities, which will make the trip more difficult to accomplish. So really, a couple of words from the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ contain a lot of meanings. I only gave you two examples, two explanations. The scholars deduce many more benefits from these two examples that the Prophet ﷺ gave Ibn Umar. Be in this dunya like a traveler, like a stranger or like a traveler. Because of this, because of his understanding, Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, used to say, إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرُ الصَّبَاحِ وَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرُ الْمَسَاءِ وَقُذْ مِنْ صَحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. Because of his understanding, Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, used to say, if you are living in the evening, do not expect to make it to the morning. And if you are alive in the morning, don't expect to make it to the evening. And take from your health while you're healthy for the time of sickness. And take from your life while you're alive for the time of death. So this is an understanding that we don't have today. By Allah, which one of us here, when he wakes up in the morning, does not expect himself to make it to the evening? Allah al-musta'an. Rather we be saying, in 3 years inshallah, I'm going to be going on a trip for such and such. And next week I'm going to be doing such and such. No harm in that. No harm in that if you are in the depth of your mind thinking that you may die tonight. But usually we are negligent about death period. Oh, I'm not gonna, it's impossible to die now. I'm too young. This is all foolishness from the shaitan. Rather, the companions of Rasulullah did not feel this way because of the advice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what we learn from this, the reason why I quoted these particular verses and this particular narration is for us to understand the opportunity that we have right now within our hands. You are alive. Allah could have taken your soul before Ramadan. Allah could have taken your soul in the beginning of Ramadan. Allah could have taken your soul before you made it to the last 10 nights. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jalla has given me and you the opportunity to remain alive, and we know that death is around the corner, and we know that the hereafter is the real home, and this is where we're supposed to build our real house, we should not be hasty, and we should not be negligent about these next few nights. These next coming nights, inshallah, until the end of Ramadan, my brothers and sisters, try to exert yourself in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may not appreciate it now, but you will definitely appreciate this advice on the Day of Judgment. On the Day of Judgment, when you need every good deed, you would wish that when you had the opportunity tonight, today, you would have done something good for your life. But the regret will not benefit of that on that day. Regret on that day is going to be of no benefit. All it's going to do is cause you heartaches and pain. It's just going to kill the person internally. The fact that he cannot go back to the dunya and fix whatever he ruined. But now, we're able to do that. Now we're able to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all our shortcomings, all our sins. Not only that, the obligations that we're supposed to carry out that we don't carry out. Seeking repentance is not only from sins. It's also from obligations that we don't carry out. Being dutiful to our parents, keeping the kinship ties. We need to repent to Allah from that. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, not only that, seeking forgiveness and repenting to Allah should also be from the voluntary acts of worship that you used to do but you stopped doing. Or that you can do but you do not do. Like the nawafil. That's all that also requires repentance. So in reality, the objective of this particular gathering here is that now that we are in these best days and nights, that we take advantage of them like an intelligent individual would, hoping that Allah Azza wa Jal will make our life a blessed one. And if Allah accepts the repentance of one of us in this on these nights, then glad tidings are for that individual for the rest of his life. No matter what happens, that person bi-idhnillah will be safe from the fire. And this is the ultimate goal for the believer. Ask Allah Azza wa Jal to allow me and you to partake in as many acts of worship as possible in these blessed nights. Before I conclude, just a quick reminder about Zakatul Fitr. Zakatul Fitr is obligatory on each Muslim, whether male or female, whether it's a free servant, it's a slave or free person, which doesn't exist today, and whether it is an old or a young person. It is a fard on each Muslim. The amount that should be given is of, first of all, it's of food, not money. Food, because at the time of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, they had money. But he commanded that the people take out food and give it to the masakeen. The food should be sa', which is equal to 4 double handfuls of whatever, dates, or barley, or raisins, or rice, or whatever food. Preferably the ones that were mentioned in the hadith, which are dates and barley, and zabib, raisins. The reason why we cannot refer to the kilo, as our Shaykh al-Shankriti, hafizahullah, mentioned, is because the weight differs depending on the item that you have in your hand. If you were to fill up 4 of these, of the average man, his hands put together, not totally stretched out and not totally closed in. If you were to put 4 of these, tayyib, if you have dates, like the rutab, the heavy ones, they may weigh 3 kilos. If you do the same thing with raisin, they'll be maybe 0.5 kilo. You see? This is why the issue is not an issue of weight, rather the sunnah is that it's supposed to be with that. For one sa', which is equal to 4 of these. And you give him to a miskeen, because the Prophet Ibn Abbas, when he mentioned that, the Prophet ﷺ said, the reason why we do this because it is purifying for our fasting. Whatever shortcomings we had in our fasting, whatever mistakes we may have made, that zakat or sadaqat al-fitr that you pay will expiate the shortcomings in the fasting. And we all need that. Allah knows what we were doing during our fasting. Allah knows how many sins we committed, backbiting and what have you. So this zakat al-fitr is very important to expiate for these shortcomings. And it is beneficial for the miskeen, for those who are needy, for the needy Muslims. The sunnah is that you pay it on the before you go to Salatul Eid. If it is difficult to do it at that time, from the night of Eid, yani from the end of Ramadan. Or according to Ibn Umar, as it was narrated by Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him, that Ibn Umar used to take it out two nights before Eid. So then there's a best time, there's an acceptable time, and there's an acceptable time. The best time is on the day of Eid or the night of Eid. And the acceptable time is two nights before Eid. You bring this particular amount of food, each on his own behalf, and you give it to one of the needy Muslims. And you must really look for the needy. Yeah, and some people think a miskeen is someone who doesn't have a Mercedes. Wallah, he's only driving a Suzuki. Miskeen. That's not a miskeen. The miskeen is someone who really needs. He's in need. This food will help him. Don't give money, because money is against the sunnah. It's a muhdath, it's something that is introduced into the deen. Furthermore, he may go buy a pack of cigarettes with it. You give him 10, 15, 20 riyals, he'll go do whatever he wants with them. You're not considered to have given him zakat al-fitr. So the sunnah is that you do it on your own. You get the food and you give it to someone who is needy. This is the ultimate reward you can get from this particular act of worship. Another reminder is regarding Salatul Eid. Salatul Eid, according to the most correct opinion, is Fardu Ayn. It's an individual obligation on each Muslim, whether male or female. If it is being conducted in a masjid, the sunnah is that it's done outside in an open area. If it is being conducted in a masjid, then the sisters who are on their menstrual cycles, they do not go to the masjid. They may go out, because the Prophet ﷺ commanded that all the women, even the wife al-Khudur, the women who used to stay at home, they would never go out. He commanded that every one of them goes out for Salatul Eid. They said, "Oh Messenger of Allah, one of us does not have a jilbab. She doesn't have any outer garment to wear." He said, "Let her sister lend her a jilbab." Trying to emphasize the importance of going out for Salatul Eid. So everybody should go out. But a reminder for the sisters. Yes, sisters. Do not go out to ruin what you have established in Ramadan. Yani abandon the things that you see common during the days of Eid. Makeup and, you know, lipstick and jewelry and rainbow colored clothes and flowers hanging from upstairs and attractive what have you. You know what I'm saying. This is not the job of the Muslim woman. The job of the Muslim woman, such as Mary, the mother of Jesus, she was a Muslim woman, is to look unattractive. Your job in the society while you're outside your home is to look boring, lame, unattractive. This is the obligation. Nothing more than that. Allah Azza wa Jalla has decreed that for your own protection. So the people who have sicknesses will leave you alone. The men who have problems in their hearts and in their minds, they will be uninterested in you. Unlike the woman who reveals her adornment, then some sick people become interested in her. And they try to go for it in a way where she accepts. If not, then they go on, a'udhu billah, they do, you know, whatever you hear on the news, a woman being taken advantage of forcefully. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of mercy to the Muslim woman, gave her a particular obligation in terms of their dress code, so they will not be harassed by people. And this is applicable to Eid. Eid, days of happiness, days of farah wa surur, enjoying oneself. It's ayyam akil wa shurb wa dhikr lillah azza wa jal, is days of eating and drinking and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And remembering Allah is remembering that Allah sees you. So you don't go out and, you know, disobey Him on the first day of Eid, right after you had been obeying Him in the month of Ramadan. So this is the advice for the sisters. Something similar can be said about the brothers. We do not want to go back to disobedience, things that we have repented from in the month of Ramadan. Go and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the first day of Eid. Go back to, you know, places where people mix and places where, you know, people disobey Allah and things of this sort. Rather, we should keep ourselves within the halal borders. Go enjoy yourself in a halal way. Go to the park, go to the beach, go wherever you want, as long as you are far away from fitna to you and to your family members. And enjoy yourself, because Allah Azza wa Jalla had made these days of enjoyment for the believers. The sunnah also is to do takbir from the night of Eid. Yani as soon as Maghrib, at the last time you break your fast, it is officially Laylatul Eid, because the next day will be Yawmul Eid. The sunnah is to get engaged in takbir. And the format is Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd. And another one is, instead of saying three Allahu Akbars in the beginning, you say two. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd. For the men, it is a sunnah, mustahab, for you to say it out loud, audibly, in the marketplace, at home, in the masjid, wherever you go, you keep saying takbir to glorify Allah Azza wa Jalla, magnify Him for what He has blessed us with and for guiding us. And you do it until the Imam gets on the minbar and gives the khutbah before the Salah, Salatul Eid. Until Salatul Eid, because the Salah is before the khutbah on Eid, unlike Jumu'ah. You continue to do the takbir. Don't be shy, don't be ashamed of the people. Say, what's wrong with this guy? Why is he walking around the street saying takbir? You're doing the takbir for the sake of Allah, not for the sake of the people. And you will, to Allah, you will be more beloved than all of these other people, because you are reviving the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are establishing a sunnah that has become abandoned in this day and time. So you say the takbir, don't worry about the people. For the sisters, you don't do it out loud. You do the takbir where you can hear yourself. You do not do it out loud. So this is the some of the things, the rulings pertaining also to Salatul Eid, that we do attend it, and we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no sunnah to pray before Eid or after Eid. If you go to the masjid, then some of the scholars say you pray tahiyyat al-masjid. If you are going to a place where it's outside the masjid, then you don't pray anything before Salatul Eid, then you don't pray anything after Salatul Eid. One more thing, before you go out to the Salah, it's a sunnah to eat dates. An odd number of dates. 1 or 3 or 5 or 7 or 9 or 11, I don't know if you can eat 11. That's a lot, mashallah. But as much as you want, as long as it's an odd number of dates, before you go out to the Salah. And the sunnah is that if you go from one way, you do not backtrack on the way back. You take another road to go back home. These are among the things that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to observe during the day of Eid. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant us the ability to reach Eid while our sins are forgiven and our deeds are accepted, and while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with all of us for whatever He allowed us to perform from the good deeds. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. If you have any questions, you may ask, inshallah. Well, actually, it depends on the nature of the injection. If it's something that is nutritious, something that will give you, it's like a substitute for food and drink, then yes, that does nullify the fasting. If it is not this kind of injection, if it's like medical injection for medicine or something of the sort, then it does not affect the fasting, inshallah. Tayyib? So it depends on the nature of the actual shot. Anything else?
Can someone ask them to do it for him in his own country? Because the reason for it is that maybe there he believes the needy, the poor over here is more than
Now, The brother's asking if you could, the zakat al-fitr, if you could actually delegate someone back in your home country to pay it as opposed to you doing it here. The fatwa that I have read is that says that that is permissible. Although the asl, the principle, is that you do it in the locality that you live in. Yet some of the scholars said, but if the situation is of such where there are more needy people back home, and you think this will be beneficial for them, then you may do that, because there's no dalil that says otherwise, and al-asl fi hadhihi al-ashya is that it is okay, as long as you're paying it off. But you have to be careful who you're assigning, and you have to make sure that this person is trustworthy, that he will do it according to the sunnah, that he will pay it before Eid. Otherwise, if you assign someone who is negligent, and they pay it after Eid or something, that you are not considered to have given zakat al-fitr. So the most safe way is that you do it yourself. The most safe way, and there are masakeen over here as well. There are masakeen over here as well. But yani, to be fair, the scholar said it is okay to do it back in your home country, but you must make sure you meet all the requirements, that it is done as if you would do it here. If someone you trust is able to carry out that particular obligation, then the scholars say there's no harm in that, inshallah. Wallahu a'lam. Yes, sister.
We sisters here already report Islam and man. Is it acceptable for us to pray with this type of clothes?
No, it is not.
So we need to wear abaya?
Naam. Naam, sister. You need to wear an abaya, and I don't know whether the hospital makes it yani compulsory on you to wear that. I have seen some sisters in other clinics and other places where the actual outside robe that you wear, you know, the white one, is actually long. It's nice and big and long all the way down to the feet. And it still has the pockets and all the gadgets that you guys need. So it's not the one that is short up to the, you know, thighs perhaps or the knees. It goes all the way down. If the hospital allows you to wear these on regular circumstances, that it is much recommended that you do so. If they're having an issue, then I'm not going to go into that. You need a fatwa. But basically, when it comes to the time of the salah, then yes. Because you do not want anything that will, especially when you may go to ruku' and sujood, you don't want anything to become shaped due to the clothes that you are wearing. You need some outer garment to cover the whole thing. So yes, inshallah, keep a jilbab with you or an outer garment that you put on whenever you do salah. And preferably if you could change the actual dress code where you avoid these pants and wear something, or at least wear something that covers them all the way to the bottom, that will be much, 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 much pleasing to Allah. Bi-ithnillah azza wa jal. So I've seen it outside and it's done. If they have an issue here, then this is none of my business. But this is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what is expected of the sister, to cover herself and to the best of her ability. Next. There's no next.
The you told him Allah says or we said in the Quran.
You could say both, because even Arabic you say يقول الله عز وجل وقال الله عز وجل. You know what I'm saying? So both are, you could say Allah said or Allah says, because it's still effective. You know what I'm saying? It's something that is being said. You may read it for the first time. So now, yes, sister, you raise your hand.
Brother, I say it, and I try my best to fast.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes I get really low blood sugar, so I break the fast before Adhan in the Maghrib time.
Okay.
Is it okay or does it nullify my fasting?
Well, of course, it does nullify your fast. But then we have another issue, is should you fast to begin with? يعني the deen of Islam is a deen of ease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants facilitation for you, and Allah does not want to cause you any difficulty. So basically, if fasting is going to cause you health problems, then it becomes obligatory on you not to fast. It becomes forbidden for you to fast. If it's going to affect you, if the doctor يعني tells you, and you're a nurse, you know better than that. If you know that this may affect you, you may faint or pass out or something along these lines, then you should not fast. Yes, and you feed a miskeen for each day that you break your fast. Okay, but for the days that you did break your fast prior to Maghrib, then you are considered to have nullified that particular day of fasting, and then if you are able to make it up in the future in case diabetes, for example, goes away, then you do so. If you think this is something permanent, then you feed a poor person for each one of these days.
One day for each show?
Nah. Alhamdulillah.
How much the amount for each day?
I'm sorry?
How much the amount for each day for the miskeen?
What I know is that يعني, a meal.
One meal for you?
No. For a poor person. Something that you would feed yourself. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك